I think now there's a very good chance that as, again, Citibank feels the pinch, and others, too, through their derivatives, through their credit default swaps. Every bank in Wall Street is linked into Barclays and Royal Bank of Scotland and HSBC through these monstrous derivatives. That what's going to happen is they're going to have to dump assets. They're going to have to start selling derivatives, selling stocks, selling commodities, selling all sorts of things, and that will then add to the panic in the U.S., although it will also add to the panic in these countries. Now, some of these countries are approaching national bankruptcy. Certainly, Ukraine, Latvia, and Iceland are all countries to immediately declare a debt moratorium, which is what I would recommend to all of them. And in all of them, there's political ferment around precisely this issue. In Ukraine, you have a lady running for president, Natalia Vitrenko, who seems to be basically saying, get the IMF out of our country. But these other Iceland, of course, the other country that urgently needs a debt moratorium, and indeed Latvia. But in some of these other countries, again, the Greece, Hungary, Turkey, India, places like this, Ireland, they may simply go into national bankruptcy. In other words, they may simply implode, because when the hot money leaves them and is called back to New York to pay these urgent debts, or if it goes somewhere else where they think the chances are better, then that essentially deflates these places and leaves them really among the ruins. So I think there's a significant potential, can't be sure quite yet, that this Dubai event is sort of the outside event that nobody had in particular been looking for, that will bring on the second wave of the depression, the second wave of the panic, the collapse of this asset bubble, which has been engineered now, not anymore by Bush and Paulson and Bernanke, but now by Obama, Geithner, Summers, and Bernanke, and make it obvious to everybody that there's still a depression and that this has not been solved. And indeed, the real economy is getting worse and worse, right, as anybody who looks at the unemployment statistics would see, right? 17% real unemployment, even in the government's terms. I would say it's closer to 25% unemployment, if you really factor in the people who are so discouraged that they don't look for work, or who never even started to look for work because they were
honest about the unemployment, Webster. I turn on CNN now, and they now have something called the 30-second spot, where people who are unemployed actually go on television and pitch themselves for a job. That's how bad it's gotten. Did you ever think we would be watching the national news and unemployed people would be on the air saying, please hire me, this is what I can do? But that's the reality today.
Well, you know, in the other depression, we had Hoovervilles, and now we have Obamavilles, right? We've got all sorts of tent cities. They're a little bit spiffier than a Hooverville, but that's what it is. And you've got a lot of desperate people. And it used to be, you know, before media, you'd go down to the city corner and you'd put a piece of cardboard around your neck and you'd say, I'm looking for work, right? Or I will work for food. And you can see these in all languages from the Great Depression. That's basically where we are. So Obama has completely failed. And obviously, one of the things you want to do when you get a worldwide panic like this, the countries that succeed generally slap on capital controls and exchange controls, which is to saying we're going to stop the flow of hot money, and they'd be well advised to slap on a 1% Tobin tax to begin this process of discouraging speculation. Because up to now, everything is done to encourage speculation. We have 0% Federal Reserve lending for speculation only, not for production, only for speculation. And it's not taxed. There's no tax on this constant flow back and forth of the hot money, right? They have flash trading, they have high-frequency trading, program trading, you know, millions of transactions per second, and that's all tax-free, right? Whereas the rest of us poor slobs, if we want to go, in many states, when you go to the grocery store and buy the food for the week for the family, you're going to be paying 6 or 8 or 10% on your grocery bill, and certainly, even if you escape that, if you have to buy clothing or shoes for your children, you're going to be paying whatever the state sales tax is. So we pay, but the bankers don't pay. And I say, time for the bankers to pay, and they should pay through the nose. And 1% is really little enough to demand of these bankers, given what they're doing. That's a way, rather than just railing against Goldman Sachs, you want to hurt Goldman Sachs, you want to shut them down, go with the Tobin tax, and that'll gouge 1% out of every one of their flash trades, and they will soon realize that flash trading is just no longer what it used to be, and they're going to have to drop that. And they're using that to bid up the price of gasoline. It'd be interesting to see what happens to the price of gasoline and oil now. It may be that as these hedge funds go bankrupt, they have to sell their positions, and it might go down a little bit.
On the other side, I want to talk to Webster about what it might look like in the market Monday morning, as well as the semantical terms they use. I mean, Obama's talking about a double-dip recession. They won't use the word depression. It's the Info Warrior with Jason Burmes. We'll be back after this. Established median still refuses to use the term depression. They just refuse to use the term depression. Barack Obama gets on television. He says, we might be in for a double-dip recession before the global economic recovery really takes place. I want to ask Webster Tarpley what he thinks about this semantic game that the elite like to play with their minions, as well as what are the scenarios we could see tomorrow, best and worst case, due to this Dubai situation, Webster?
Well, first of all, this quibbling about depression is completely idiotic. This is a world economic depression. When you have, as we've had it, the overall level of world trade, the single biggest indicator of everything going on in the world, is international trade. And according to the WTO, World Trade Organization, that had declined by almost 40% from the peak reached in 2008 to the low reached a little bit earlier now in 2009. So minus 40% on world trade is a depression, and it's actually more. We have had what amounts to the disintegration of the U.S. and British banking system, so that these are now wards of the government, meaning that they're the recipients of the money of the taxpayer. These are zombie banks. They do not lend. They don't provide credit for plant and equipment or any commerce or anything of that sort. They simply sit there. They try to charge you fees. They rook you. They bid up the price of oil. They do their proprietary trading, which is damaging to the public interest. And, of course, they trade derivatives, including these credit default swaps, which are now going to bring them down again, because undoubtedly the credit default swaps from Dubai are all over Wall Street, and that will create, you know, more massive losses, that which this time are going to be passed on immediately to John Q. Public. I would say it's a depression. It's a disintegration. And by disintegration, I mean something like the collapse of 1987 in the stock market. That's just a collapse. Goes down, comes up again. A disintegration is something like the German hyperinflation of 1923, or when the British defaulted on gold payment in September 1931 and destroyed the world monetary system. Those are disintegrations. In other words, they actually destroy institutions and don't leave anything in their place. And I would call it also a breakdown crisis of imperialism in general, because it corresponds to this total crisis of the U.S. as an empire, as a military operation, as a reserve currency, the dollar, of course, in big crisis in that regard. So it's it gets to be a total crisis of world civilization. So it's far more than simply a recession, right? You've had so many of those. This is much worse. Now, in terms of tomorrow, I'm just looking during the break. Now, most of the weekend, the New York futures were signaling down 200, right? A fall of 200 at the opening. But now, the wonderful work of the plunge protection team is now in evidence, because it's now up 30 at the opening. So this PPT, again, using Federal Reserve money, has come in, and they've bought up those stock futures to try to prop it up and try to stem the panic. And whether that works is anybody's guess. Japan has just opened now, and the Nikkei seems to be up about 1%, where everybody had thought it would be down, right? Continuing the trend of Thursday and Friday in particular, when Japan was down. Now, in Japan, they do it openly and legally. They have something called the Stock Buying Authority. And the Japanese Stock Buying Authority goes out and buys stock to try to prop up the market and prevent, you know, gap down. And they want to avoid situations where there are no buyers, only sellers. So they do all that. So fine. How long they can keep that up, I really don't know. And, you know, what the next piece of bad news will be, I also don't know. But it is significant that all of this is going on. And it also adds to the sense in the world that theories about the weather, you know, your concern for the penguins or the polar bears, That's all well and good. But when you have high unemployment, or maybe not well and good, as I would say, but when you have really high unemployment and they have a second round of financial panic, you just can't afford that kind of nonsense, right? You simply can't afford it. So that would be the lesson for this Copenhagen gathering of ghouls and vampires and charlatans and quackademics starting on December 7th, right? That this is not a good backdrop for them. To have this Dubai stuff going on.
And we're only a week away from that, of 9 days to be exact. These emails leaking and then Barack Obama saying he's going to attend indicates to me that they're just going to continue their push for global governance. Now, I want to get your take, whether you think people are going to be signing on to this Copenhagen Treaty, whether this will really be three pillars, one of which is world government, and how they can just ignore all this data that has been leaked to the mainstream media, and the media trying to do spin control right now. We'll be back after this with Webster Griffin Tarpley. You can get all his books over at Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.tv.